All right, it looks like we're pretty well gathered back. And if there are a few of you, I don't know if you can hear me in the other room, but we'll go ahead and get started now. One theme that I think I picked up on between the two speakers that we enjoyed earlier today was that Sacred Harp is something that really happens around people, that it's not just a written tradition, as Warren spoke to, and that there are these rich histories that Buell discussed as well. So we're fortunate today. We've got a bunch of the Sacred Harp people with us, people with a lot of experience and a wide, diverse backgrounds in Sacred Harp. So let me just very quickly introduce everyone. I'm going to start by introducing our moderator, who is Jesse Perlman-Carlsberg, who is a doctoral student at Emory University who studies Sacred Harp. He's probably the most knowledgeable person about the little minutia. If you have a, yeah. Well, we'll let them fight over it. Anyway, pleased to have Jesse here with us. To Jesse's right is Judy Cottle from Eva, Alabama. You might not know where that is, even if you're from Alabama, but it's in Morgan County, I'm told, not too far from Coleman, who's a lifelong Sacred Harp singer. Her father actually is a longtime singing school teacher in that part of the state. We've already met Buell on the end and Warren next to Jesse. We've also got Bill Hogan with us today, who's representing a little bit further south in Alabama, who's in, where are you exactly?
In Wetumpka.
And is our honorary representative from the Cooper book here. You may be aware we have a few different editions of the Sacred Harp, so we're very, very proud to have Bill with us. We've also got David Ivey, who has a long history of Sacred Harp in his family as well, is the director of Camp Fossil Law and has recently been awarded an extremely prestigious national award, the National Heritage Fellowship. And then last but definitely not least is Bridget Hill Kennedy, who is from here or around here in the Birmingham area. So we have her representing locally. She also has a long history of Sacred Harp going back into the early 2000s and has been a very popular, probably the most popular teacher, I think, at Camp Fossil Law. So we're very proud to have her with us as well. Let me go ahead and turn the time over to Jesse to get us started with our discussion.
Thanks. Thank you, Nathan. So it's great to have so many of you here with us, and wonderful to see this exhibit and to hear these great talks. And so what we're going to do for this hour is I'm going to ask a few questions of these esteemed singers, and we'll basically just have a discussion about Sacred Harp singing, about what Sacred Harp singing means to those of us who sing this music. Talk about some of the different ways that the people on this stage have gotten involved. Perhaps even talk about how Sacred Harp has changed, and then I want to spend a little time at the end talking about the future of Sacred Harp. But to start, I think it would be great if each of you all could just say a few words about how you became involved in Sacred Harp singing, whether that happened when you were very, very, very young or later on in life, how you got involved and what drew you in to Sacred Harp. And if you'd like to start, Bill, and then we can maybe just move down the line.
Okay, I'll be glad to start. I was later in life, I had learned to sing from my father and with family things and in church, but in 1996, there was a workshop in Mobile at our church in Christian Harmony. Laura Boosinger from North Carolina was there, and she gave a three-day workshop, and I attended, and I thought it was interesting, and I bought the book, and I thought it was interesting, cool music from 1856 or whatever, so, and I liked that, and Bill Green was at the singing, and he invited everyone there to come to the Baldwin County singing, which was 2 weeks away, and I went. And he gave me a book on that occasion, and I enjoyed it. And I wondered why everybody was singing so loud, though. Were they angry about something, or you know, I hadn't seen that much emotion in a singing event before. Mm. So, but anyway, I enjoyed it very much, and attended several singings that year, and met Buell at the National on a day or two of it, and just fell in love with it from that point on.
Great, thanks, Bill.
Yes, thank you.
So Jesse, I was born into a Sacred Harp family, and some of the earliest memories I have is singing sacred harp. Really, in church is probably what I first remember. And we still sing sacred harp at Liberty Baptist Church where I grew up. So I've been singing all of my life. Folks grow up singing sacred harp, and then they leave it for years and come back. But I never have. I've sung through, when I was kidding, high school and college and so on. Mm-hmm. So.
In 2003, I was preparing to graduate with my undergraduate degree. And in the meantime, I was applying to graduate schools in the area. I was also playing drums at my church. So we were kind of raucous, the type of worship music that I was involved in. My sister-in-law, Beth Ann Hill, was invited by Max Barafee to go to a singing because he commissioned her to do a painting of a sacred harp singing. And she, knowing that I was involved in music ministry, invited me to go along with her. And I'm giving you the very, very brief version of this story. So I went along and found it fascinating, not only the music, but the people. I was instantly embraced. We were very unsure of our surroundings as we got deeper and deeper into the woods. I grew up in Birmingham during the 70s, so it was shortly after the big part of the civil rights movement. And so even though my family, we were well-traveled, it was okay to hop on an airplane, go to California, go to New York. But as far as how we moved about in Alabama, it was pretty, pretty restricted. So it was interesting to go deep and deep and deeper into the woods, mm-hmm. and just to be embraced by the individuals singing this music. It was as much of a part that drew me into it as the music itself, and so.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know when I first attended a singing, but in high school I grew up, doing all kinds of music, and in high school discovered a copy of the Southern Harmony in the public library, and tried to sing those and tried to get my friends to sing them, and all through college in the Boston area, and finally I was out of college for 4 years, and finally found a group of people in the Boston area who were getting together for the specific purpose of singing sacred harp every 2 weeks. Hmm. And that was January 1972. And in July 1972, I was in Clay County, Alabama, at a now discontinued singing. We drove a bunch of people down to, and had singing in Ann Arbor, Michigan in the 70s, and I moved to Mississippi in 1980. Still do many other kinds of music, but I've always loved the sacred harp the best.
Thanks, Warren.
My turn. My story's boring. I was born into this. I've been doing it all my life. My daddy was a singing school teacher. My grandpa was a singing school teacher. So I've attended numerous singing schools all over my lifetime, and it's just a part of me. I can't walk away from it.
Did you ever quit and come
back? No, I have never quit and come back. I've always been singing.
Well, as I mentioned in the chapter that I read earlier about Granny Cobb, she was the first one, I think, who mentioned Sacred Harp to me and sang just a little bit for me. And I think it was significant that what she sang to me stayed with me, that I still remembered those few phrases many years later. But I went to school, as I mentioned earlier, at Alabama College, now the University of Montevallo, and was fortunate there in that Mike Hinton transferred in from junior college. He, along with Richard Malden here, are grandsons of the greatest sacred harp teacher, Tom Denson, who was reputed to have taught 25,000 students over the decades. Was a greatly esteemed singing master. And Mike introduced me to the first two record albums of the Sacred Harp Publishing Company, and I was just floored by it. Well, I should mention, actually back up and mention, that I did attend a Sacred Harp singing first, and I'm just still chagrined and surprised at myself that it just made no real impression at all. If I could, just go back in time to the old Coleman courthouse that's now been dismantled. I went with my grandparents, with Granny Cobb, and I'm sure at her request. And there was this huge crowd of singers. We were up in the balcony, the mezzanine that ringed the big courtroom there, and it just didn't make an impression. It didn't grab me at all. Then when I heard those record albums, it was just a life-changing event. I knew instantly that I loved it and wanted to find out more about it. And then I began to pester everybody I knew. you must hear this music. You must find out about it.
Thanks, Bill. Thanks, everyone. What's my story? All right, fine. Yeah, well, so I started singing in the year 2000 when I was an undergraduate at Wesleyan University. And there's a person who's still in the music department there named Neely Bruce, who has a song in our book that we don't sing very much, but it is in there. and he had started singing when he was in college. He had started singing in the 1960s in Illinois and came down to sing it. In David's neck of the woods and down into Cullman and all in various parts of Alabama when he was in graduate school. So he started singing with people at his university in Illinois, and when he got his job at Wesleyan, he thought it might be interesting to try to get people singing that music at that time. So it was a little while after, I guess, Warren, you were singing in Boston. But there weren't at that time any singing conventions, any formal large Sacred Harp singings outside of the South. And he wound up collaborating with Hugh McGraw, who was the lead reviser of the book that we sing out of now, to start the first of those in 1976. So I just happened to be at that university and in a class that he was teaching the year that that convention again swung around through Middletown, Connecticut. And whenever that would happen, he would try to drum up a little bit of student interest. And he taught a section of a course called Worlds of Music. I think the other sections were on klezmer and on West African drumming. And I don't regularly do either of those things at this point in my life. but his section was just a Sacred Harp singing school. And so I found it, I think that I actually didn't find it immediately very appealing. I think at the beginning, it was just something I was doing in class, and I thought I'd go to the singing to see what it was all about, and I was horribly ill. So I wound up staying for about a half hour of it. But it was the best food that I'd had at that point in my entire, time in college. So there was like enough to keep me, to get me to come back again. And I think I just gradually became more and more interested. And once I was out of college, I looked for singings in Boston where I moved. And then when I moved to upstate New York, I looked for singings there. And as I started to get to know, be welcomed into these communities and places that I was moving to where I didn't have a network of people, I started to see that there was something more to this than just a musical activity I might do here and there. I think it just increasingly became a big part of my life. But enough about me for the moment. One thing that I found interesting listening to what everyone was just saying is that, clearly there's a whole variety. You have people, like several of us who didn't grow up singing Sacred Harp and who had to find it somehow, and then others of us who didn't have to find Sacred Harp, who were placed at a singing, before they could move on their own about space. And I think what David just said, that that some people who grew up singing Sacred Harp maybe went away for a time, and of those, some came back and others didn't. But what that shows is that all of the people who sing Sacred Harp have chosen to sing Sacred Harp, right? You don't remain a Sacred Harp singer or become a Sacred Harp singer without deciding to do that. And so that makes me wonder why do people choose to sing Sacred Harp? So I wonder if each of you could say something about why do you sing Sacred Harp? What does Sacred Harp singing mean to you? How does it fit into your life? And has that changed over time? Have those things changed? And maybe this time we'll start at Buell's end of the table.
Well, as I mentioned, the sound that I heard was so amazing to me and so amazingly right. It seemed basic in a way that other musics weren't. Every song seemed written for me. It just was instantly appealing all the way through. The words, the music, everything about it, the pacing. And then I was taken by the fact that I was associating myself with something very old that went back in history, that had a long tradition to it. And I was associating myself with the people who had done it, the hundreds of thousands who had sung Sacred Harp. For the most part, hardworking people, yeoman people across the stretches of the Deep South. So that was appealing to, it was just appealing on a number of levels. And then I suppose past a point, the fact that I could help maybe in a small way sustain a tradition that was very much in danger, it seemed to us at the time, of fading away. It seemed like when I first started singing, there was a good possibility that it might not last beyond the century, because so many of the singings were dying and singers were predominantly older at that time. And for me since, it's been really marvelous to have participated in this resurgence that it is experiencing, and that it branches out now to areas and peoples now all across the world, which is something I and certainly many others never saw coming when I back in the mid 60s. Mm.
I'm going to try to relate a story to you that kind of expresses what Sacred Harp is to me. I was privileged this past weekend to attend the Missouri State Convention. On Sunday afternoon, after the class had rendered the song The Trumpet, there was a gentleman in the class that was very moved, and he expressed his joy by shouting. And I was privileged to be a witness to his communion with the Spirit. And I was taken away from the troubles and the turmoil of this world, and for a few seconds, I found peace and joy. And that's what Sacred Harp is for me. It's an escape. I can leave all the troubles behind. I can enjoy peace for a few minutes, and sometimes even for a whole day. However, the people, that's what attracts me so much. I love to sing the music. I was born into a singing family, so singing is just natural for me, but the people is what keeps me coming back and coming back. Thank you.
Thanks. Do I have to go now? I can't get out of answering my own questions. Yes. Oh well. Okay. Yeah. Well. So one of the people that really impressed me a lot when I was first getting more into singing Sacred Harp was a man named George Seiler, who was a bass singer who lived in New Jersey, and then eventually in New York, which is where I knew him. And when I lived in upstate New York, I was living just about 3 hours away from my family. Now I'm 15 hours away from my family. And George and his wife Jean were like, you know, parents to me. Like, they didn't need to be, but when I emailed them to ask them, is this singing still scheduled? And they said yes, and I walked through the door, I was immediately a part of their family. And many of the other singers in that area were the same way. And George would elbowing me in the ribs whenever I like messed up a note sitting next to him. So he was giving me like a kind of a musical education. But more than that, they would have me over to their house. They would, you know, check on me. They made me feel, you know, like I was a part of a network of people that loved each other. And I needed that. And what George would always say is that first people come to Sacred Harp, I think he would say for the food or something. First they come for them. And I think this was his experience because his wife was maybe initially more interested than he was. But you know, if you like Sacred Harp singing and your spouse doesn't, surely your spouse likes food. So you could get them to his singing. It's possible. And then he became captivated eventually with the music, so he'll say that. But then after a while, he started to realize, like Judy said, that this is really all about the people. And it's about the people, and it's about this experience that we get to have together, where we experience God, where we, through facing each other and through singing, singing at each other and singing into this empty space that each of us gets to stand in, we're able to reach a kind of a synchrony and harmony that's a musical synchrony, but it's also very much an emotional and a spiritual synchrony. And so there's times that a singing where I feel things that I generally don't otherwise feel. And it's just a great thing to be a part of.
Okay, to make it simple, I guess.
Mike.
to make it simple, first it was the music that attracted me, for even before I heard it, seeing it in the Southern Harmony songbook, and then trying to make that into a sound, and then finally, you know, just before I heard recordings of it and everything, but still it was the music, and then the words. Not every word is my theology, but it's so eloquent. It speaks, and it speaks in ways that a lot of our own culture and our own even modern church music doesn't even deal with half of those things, and so it shows a larger, you could say, a larger size of the human condition than a lot of pop music and sacred music do, so. And then finally, you know, and especially since moving to Mississippi, but that was over 30 years ago, the people and the community, the preparing, we don't have a large group of singers in Oxford, but when we're all working to prepare for a singing, a lot of people coming, some people even brought food from Alabama. I couldn't believe it. All the way. But... that's and as I was saying before, I'm in a lot of kind of music, but this is a kind of music that's not bought and sold, and that makes it very special to me, and it's something that we make and we're part of. It's not something that we consume and buy.
As I mentioned before briefly, I was active in music ministry in my church. If there's anyone in this room who's ever been active in ministry, you know that it can wear you out. You put out, you put out, you put out. And it was to the point, I was working under a wonderful music minister, but he was a real perfectionist. And I was not being fed spiritually the way I needed to be, because we were rehearsing during Bible study, we were rehearsing during Sunday school, we were rehearsing during, so it's like I got a snippet of the sermon and then it was back to playing, and I was dying. And when I first started singing Sacred Harp, I used to envy the lifelong singers, the people who were born doing this, like, oh, you know every note, you know every word, you don't even have to look at your book. You know, I want it to be as good as those individuals who had been singing all of their lives. But then I realized that I was having a born again experience again. And that's what Sacred Harp Excuse me. That's what it's been to me. Not only do I get to put out and put out and put out, but when you're in a singing, you're being fed as well, and you're helping feed others. And it's a wonderful, wonderful thing to be a part of that. So when I talk to other singers, the more I meet other singers, especially like at camp and during times at singings where you get to talk to other individuals who are secondary singers, people who have come into the tradition as adults, for instance, you learn more about how they got to be a part of the tradition. And the one reoccurring theme is they needed it. So I sing Sacred Harp because I need it. I sing it because I can't stop. So that sums it up. All right.
Thank you.
I couldn't stop either, Bridget. When you asked this question, I thought, I never thought about what would I do, you know. But just to amplify on a couple of things that others have said, and Buell mentioned the connections back in time. When we sing songs, almost any song we sing connects me with a singer I've sung with before. Might be a relative, it might just be someone else that I admired, but you know, that's... And then today, when we have as many young folks as we do, I feel like it's connected me ahead, if that makes sense. One thing that someone hasn't no one's mentioned is when we, in Sacred Harp, when one of our singers dies, we sing for them. So it's not uncommon to have an hour singing as a part of the funeral. You might think, gosh, I never thought of that. My mother died in 2011, and so we picked the songs, had the list. My son actually directed most of the songs, and I went there thinking, I won't be able to sing. And but when the singing started, I had a piece, I guess, and I was able to sing every song actually sitting there. So I'm sorry I'm emotional, but I felt it coming, but I couldn't do anything about it. But anyway, those are just some examples of some ways you can feel connected. And certainly, you've heard very little about the fahs and the souls here, and the scales and the harmonies even, have you? You've heard a lot about the people. Of course, we definitely enjoy the singing when we're doing it and the music, but appreciate the opportunity.
Okay, I guess a lot of what I've heard as we've gone along and I've thought a lot about is it's actually a part of who we are. Some people say we're wired for it, but I would say we are made for it. You know, if we're in the image of God, God's the creator too, and this is certainly creative music. And one thing it does, it helps us to start to pay attention, less attention to the standards of the world and of what entertainment is and the culture is, and to what true beauty can be, and appreciate the beauty that God gives each of us as we share the music. And you don't have to have a whole lot to be happy. A songbook and maybe something to share for lunch and some time to get to a singing and sing for the day and enjoy everybody's company. And when I talk to people that are not singers, I tell them I consider the music devotional music, because we sing it for each other and for God and for ourselves, and we don't clap for ourselves. We don't make a big to-do about songs necessarily, unless it's a newcomer or a young person. But it's something that we want to share, and that makes it very rich to me in my life and to everybody. And Also, like several people have mentioned, I'm very thankful to Bill Green. He invited me every couple weeks or so to come to his house, and we'd sing some songs. And he would tell me his family stories about sitting on his dad's knee and singing in Hopewell and different places and their life experience. And Donald Smith also taught me a lot about Christian harmony and singing full voice and getting involved with the singing. And John Etheridge started working with us in South Alabama. We're the Denson tradition is growing great. Other traditions are sort of languishing. The Cooper edition and Christian harmony are languishing somewhat. And you do get that feeling sometimes that the tradition could be a generation away from not carrying on. But we love and enjoy the music, and it does minister to us, and we love to sing and share it with other people. So it's good to be here and good to visit and talk and sing. Yeah.
Thanks, Bill, and thanks, everyone. Did you have a question back there or something?
I just wanted to give you, everybody here has been in Sacred Harp music for some time, they've lived it and so forth and so on. And I just like to give you my perspective. I'm a person who began the study of music at knee high. And we played piano and instruments in the band and all that sort of thing. Then I went to the conservatory and graduated from the conservatory and got a master's degree in music and had never heard the words Sacred Harp. Had never heard them. And so after I retired, I came back to Huntsville, which is where my sister lives, and someone in my church said something to me about Sacred Harp. And I said, Sacred Harp? What is that? I am a music, I've studied music all this time and I've never heard anything about Sacred Harp. So he said, well, I'll take you up to Burritt and you can hear some of it. So I went up there and I was just overwhelmed. I was overwhelmed. Now, I should say too, at the time that I came back to Alabama, I was born and brought up in Birmingham, but I belonged to the 16th Street Church and they absolutely did not sing that music. So when I heard it and I thought to myself, lots of questions came to my mind. Why, out of a lifetime of studying music, have I never heard of Sacred Harp? That question came to my mind. And I've been trying to find, I've been delving into it ever since. I plan to write about it at some time.
Nonetheless.
And the other thing, I go to all of these things, this kind of thing, because I hear things here that distinguish, make me aware of what the difference is between Sacred Harp music. For instance, this morning, just sort of as a throwaway thing, Mr. Steele said it's not commercial music. It's not commercial. That's very important. And aside from that, what I have picked up at this particular meeting is that when I came back to Alabama, I came out of a situation that was where I was at my lowest ebb, and I think I was coming back home to try to find myself again. And when I went to that Sacred Harp, that singing up in Burritt, it just changed my life completely. And I've been involved in it ever since, because it really is something that is personal. It's very personal. And there's something you get out of it that you don't get out of other things. And that's all there is to it. It is unique. And I'm so glad that it is being revived and brought back, because there's nothing else like it.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks for those comments. So I guess I want to ask a couple of more questions before we move across the road and do some actual singing. And it's a funny point that we really haven't talked much about what Sacred Harp music actually is. Maybe we'll continue not to talk much about that so that you just have to stick around if you want to hear Sacred Harp singing and find out more about what it actually is. What Bill's comment made me think about, and I wanted to ask about this more, and that's also come up in a couple of other people's remarks, is that we talk about Sacred Harp being as something, singing as something that's very old, that connects us to the past, that's been going on for a long time. But clearly, Sacred Harp is also something that's going on now. So in a way, it's new. And it seems like in certain ways, it's changed. And you can take this question however you want to, but in what ways have you observed Sacred Harp to change? People have talked about this feeling that they had at a certain time that maybe the future of Sacred Harp singing wasn't certain. I've heard many people talk about other ways, just that the practices of the singing were different. And I just wonder what would each of you pick as maybe one or two different either specific ways or more general ways in which Sacred Harp singing has changed over your lifetime, over your experience with it. And maybe we'll start at Bill's end again with that one. Not to pick on.
That's okay. I would just speak to the lady's question a second. Partly the music is not a part of common culture is because music education moved on to newer ways of teaching music and left behind the shape notes and the music of the shape notes, and just in a word or two. But a lot could be said about that. But I guess maybe we're being a little more. We've been pretty personal with our comments, but it has changed some for me, but not a whole lot. Our singers in South Alabama are getting older, and we're having some new blood. We're glad to have Ryan and Nicole join us, and we have people joining every day. Maybe not as fast as we would like. I think we'll see some singings go away, and maybe some new singing started. And so there's opportunities, I would say, with Cooper and with Christian Harmony too. We're finding people enjoy Christian Harmony, and Camp Do-Re-Mi is certainly helping some, as Camp Fa-Sol-La has really helped Sacred Harp. So we have optimism for the future.
Of course, we do not know, but I rather think if we had recordings of the mid-19th century to hear, that we might not sound much different from them. I mean, their tempos change, and some, you know, they may sing slower than, based on what we know about some of the things in the rudiments, how they were written. But at least in my lifetime, 30, 40, 50 years ago, if you went to a Sacred Harp singing, you were mostly with people like you. You were in a fairly small community. Mm. Folks who were there were probably from within like a 30 or 40 or 50 mile radius at most. And that's the biggest change to today. Most of our singings, we have people from a 200 mile radius or from other states. I remember once when I was a kid, someone showed up at Liberty from Illinois, and it was just like someone had landed from Mars. I mean, you didn't see people; nobody knew about us. I mean, it's one of the things. What Sacred Harp was not in newspapers, or it wasn't in television, and it wasn't necessarily something. If you're a kid, that was cool. This was old. They call this the book we sing from. When I was a kid, I didn't even know it was called Sacred Harp so much. I was an old book singer. Mm-hmm. And there was sort of I think there was some stigma attached to that, and I think Buell has talked about that some possibly today. One thing that's changed is now for young people, it's a cool thing to do. You know, it's been in a movie and those sorts of things. But in terms of the singing, when we gather now and we have people from all over, we don't know how each other sings so much. Mm-hmm. Whereas in a small community, you know, we sang pretty much the same tempo, the same song. Our repertoire was smaller. Mm-hmm. We sing more songs now, for example. So we have to work harder as singers at singers now to stay together and have a better sound. And staying together when we sing is very important to us. That's more important than singing the right tones, is to stay together on time. Hmm. So I'll stop there. That's
great. Thanks.
David took part of my answer. I think that this question might be better addressed by people who've been singing for a much longer period of time than I. I mean, I can't imagine that there's been any great change in the last, 11 years. But you did touch on something very important, David. There are those regional differences. And when I first started to sing, I traveled a lot with Elaine Stovall, who's in back. Raise your hand, Elaine. Those early days, she was like one of my greatest singing mentors, and we would talk about singings going back and forth. And it was, she would tell me things like, you know, in where we're going today, they sing them a little bit faster. You know, or where we're going this time, you know, there you're going to notice that it's a little bit slower. And she would always teach me to, you know, watch, observe the traditions of, you know, a particular region. And but David mentioned, I mean, people have been traveling to singings long before I started. But I, you know, with people moving about more and more, you can go to a singing where things have been reputed to be slower. For the duration of the singing, you can notice, you know, people from other areas come to sing, they pick it up. And so, you know, there's a great bit of variation, or a little bit more than I observed when I was a newer singer. But I think, you know, that's not one of the things that I've really just gone over and over in my head. It's a personal thing for me, and so I've observed more, I guess, how I've changed since I've been singing. And perhaps if you ask me in another 10 or 12 years, then I'll be able to give you a little more on that topic. So.
Yeah, I have to say, I'm maybe not quite as sanguine, at least about Sacred Harp in the traditional areas in the South, because, you know, every time we read a memorial list, I think, you know, do we have younger singers who are becoming as active as those people were, or maybe a while? And, you know, we do our best. And but as David says, it takes people from a wider area to make a good singing than it used to. As where when I used to go over to Winston County, and everybody would be from within 20 miles, and they just sing like they've been singing together all their life, and they have. And you know, you can still hear hints of that, but it is true. It's amazing that, you know, the spread we've got now in Europe and the British Isles, especially, but and all over the U.S. and Canada. But to find it here, you know, the people that in a college town, you get a little bit of a distorted view, because you get people that are gung-ho, they're interested, and they want to come all the time. And then, you know, 2-3 years later, boom, they're gone. And you know, where we have to start over again. You know, that's the way it is. And that's, I know, probably that way in Atlanta, too. But we gotta work at it anyway.
Thanks. Yeah, I'm going to pass on this one because I've only been singing for like 15 years.
And he looks at me.
And I look at you.
Okay. Okay. I got this.
Yeah, you got it.
One thing that I've noticed that has changed drastically from when I was a little girl, the singings are not as resolute. Hmm. We had... When I was learning to lead, you had people sitting on the front bench, and if you were singing too fast to suit them, they told you to slow down. If you were singing too slow, they told you to speed up. But I don't see that much anymore. Mm. The atmosphere is a little more relaxed. it's still important and somber, and the singing itself is a spiritual experience, but it's not quite as strict as I remember from when I was younger. It's kind of relaxed a little bit, and I think that may be one thing that has brought some people in, because those guys sitting on that front bench when I was a kid, I was a bunch of stern faces I was looking into. It's intimidating.
They scare you. Right?
Very intimidating. And I don't think we have that so much anymore, so maybe that's a good change.
But you can set them straight.
I can.
But in a friendly way.
Yes.
Somewhat
yes.
Friendly. Friendly enough.
I could comment on a number of things that, picking up what David and Warren and Judy have mentioned. When I first started singing, there were many more singings all through the South than there are now. And as has been mentioned, many of those singings were populated by people from within the immediate area. You know, as things change so often, I think we see the pros and cons just on balancing always the way they change. We're always still got the balance. Technology today is wonderful, but with it, it brings all these new kind of problems we didn't have before. When Sacred Heart began to be spreading outside, and we had people from a broader area, then the singing gets by, even though there are fewer communities that do it still. Something that Judy mentioned reminds me, I think the singing today is probably more democratic than it has ever been. In the old days, only a few people led. There, what was called the lesson, your time up before the group, was 30 minutes in the mid-19th century. That had come down to about 20 minutes and then 15 minutes in the earlier part of this century. So only the best leaders led. And today we expect that at any singing you go to, anyone who wants to lead gets the opportunity to do so. And there is that increasing informality that I think Judy was mentioning just now, too. It's less autocratic in a way. The singing just has a more democratic spirit. And finally, I would just say, I think the singing today at its best is the best it has been since I heard it in the 60s. And one reason for that is so many more of the singers now are self-selected singers. They're people who come to us who want to sing, whereas in the old days, you were just a member of the family. There were eight of you or 13 of you or whatever, and everybody sang. And today, people come to it who really love it and intend to make it better. And I think at its best, I think the singing today is as good as I've ever heard it.
Thanks. I want to ask one more quick question. I know we're just about out of time, and I want everyone to get to sing Sacred Harp. But my last question is just looking towards the future. What does the future hold for Sacred Harp? And you can either speak to that or on a more concrete level. If someone here wanted to get involved in Sacred Harp singing, if someone here wanted to do more than just go sing for a couple of hours across the street, what's a great way for them to get involved in Sacred Harp? Who wants to? And I won't even say who's going to start. You all can just pick who wants to go first, and then someone else can go after that.
It's well, I think I'll excuse myself since I already talked about the future as I saw it.
Very good. That's fair.
I want to say something about getting involved. If you want to get involved in Sacred Harp singing, the best way to do it is to go sing. And this, I've noticed a difference between people who start singing by attending the local singings that may take place like once a month. There's a difference between individuals who sing that way and individuals who attend all day singings, because people who start off at the local singings tend to kind of get an idea that that's all there is. And it's rare that you ever see them branch out and start going to all day singings. So if you're going, you know, if you want to be a Sacred Harp singer, I encourage you to go to an all day singing. let that be your first experience, if at all possible. And you know, if you're worried about, I don't think I'm going to ever be able to catch on to this, believe me, there are people there willing to help you. And the more you go, the better you get at it. And that's not even the important part. The more you're going to get out of it in general, just getting to know the people. So,
thanks.
Yes.
So, Jesse, I'm more optimistic now than I've ever been about the future of Sacred Heart. A few years ago, we were at camp, and Jeff Shepherd, who co-founded camp with me, Camp Fossilized, said, we have these young people, and he was talking about some of our teachers then, people like Jesse, who were teaching at camp. But he's also talking about kids. They're so smart. They're so much smarter than we were when I was growing up. And what he meant is that they had more opportunities for education.
That's right.
And to learn and about what they're doing. Now, when we teach singing, is when I teach singing, because I, at least much like Bridget said, you learn by going and singing. And then in singing schools, we're teaching folks what we're doing. Yeah. This is what we're sort of what we're doing. Yeah. But if we look at today, I think we have a lot of young people really in a lot of different communities throughout the country. We started Camp Fossil in 2003. And one of the things that constrained us and what we could do at this camp was we didn't have enough teachers. And today, we have more teachers than I can even program and schedule at three camps. And a lot of those people have learned to teach. I mean, any of us who try to do this pretty much learn it by going to other singing schools. That's been how singing school teachers have been trained, throughout our history. But a lot of these folks have had the experience of attending other singing schools throughout the country, but also they've learned it by coming to the camp that we have, and I think that's helped. So I'm very optimistic and really traject ahead a lot of activity.
Thanks.
I think it will continue to be very spread like it is now. Mm-hmm. You know, but...
Mm-hmm. Anyone else want to weigh in on that? I wanted to just say concretely, go to Camp Fasola. Yes. So you know, any of you who are interested can go to this camp. There's an adult oriented session, which is not terribly far from here. It's in Winston County, at David. Do you have the dates, Sandy? Do you want to say?
I have flyers for singings and for camp outside on one of the tables. But the adult camps at Camp McDowell, an Episcopal camp between Jasper and Double Springs.
Great.
The youth camp, which is first week of July, is near Anniston at Camp Lee. And then if you want to go to Poland, we'll have another Camp Europe this year. And we have a trip organized, so see me if you want to go.
So go to Camp Fasola. Go to fasola.org and look up the directory of singings. You can find singings. There's singings in parts of Alabama just about every weekend. So you have ample opportunities. You are uniquely well situated of people anywhere in the world to really do more than just dip your toes in, but to dive headfirst into this music. And as you can see, you couldn't make a better decision. Buell.
Yeah, for people in the Birmingham area or who wouldn't mind driving to the Birmingham area, we have a monthly evening singing, the first Tuesday evening, beginning at 6:30 to 8:30 at Southside Baptist Church. It's a great room that allows 20 people to sound like 200. Mm-hmm. And we go over songs and practice songs, and it's a very strong group, and so that they can carry you along on any song you would want to sing. And it's a great opportunity to learn and to spread your wings in Sacred Heart. So that's please nice. Come join us there, for those who might be interested. See some of us at the break, and we can give you more details
There's
about that.
There's also a three-day convention in Birmingham, in Shelby County, actually.
Yes, thank you, Warren. Yeah. And Warren and I are two of the now three people who've attended all 34 of those sessions. it will be at the First Christian Church on Valleydale Road, just south of Birmingham, the 3 days before Father's Day, June 12th, 13th, and 14th, the Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And it's a great sound there. It's Hubert Knoll's home church, and a great place to sing and fellowship. Thank you for mentioning that, Warren. Mm-hmm.
Jesse.
Yeah.
He said a word there called fellowship. Singing is not just about the singer.
Mm-hmm.
It's about the people. And the people that you get to know and that you share life's experience with, and this music, and it puts a little seed in your heart, and it grows through your soul, and you cannot go to a singing without thinking of the people who aren't there any longer, and the people that you're sharing that with that day, and the fellowship. And that, to me, is the cord around your heart, Jewel, that touches you every time you go to a singing. It's not what you're singing. But then becomes your life and your experience. And you take that and you go out, and it changes your whole attitude and a lot of things outside of the singing. And the people that I have met singing in Sacred Heart are some of the finest and most caring people that you can meet in the whole world. And that's a very big part of it.
Thanks. Yeah, thanks, Richard. I really appreciate each of the singers on this panel for really giving of themselves and of their experiences and sharing that with us all and speaking from their hearts. This has been really, I think, a great experience for me. I appreciate everyone doing it, and I appreciate you all being here to listen. I think we have a few announcements before we